Brought to you by
Eaton Detroit Spring. Proudly made in the USA.
Classic car or muscle car, we want to show you how to restore your automobile and save yourself some money in the process. Sometimes we consult the pros, sometimes we mess up. But just remember, it's never a problem, it's always a project.
This week on Autorestomod, Jeff talks about his method and order when building a classic car for street, cruise, or show.
Honey, what are you doing out there?
Waiting on the next Super Blowout 3-day only mega sale.
You don't need a sale. You need NPD.
NPD's everyday prices are competitive with most sales, and orders arrive fast from our four strategically located superstores. National Parts Depot has quality parts for Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, GTO, Firebird, Ford, and Chevy truck. For your free catalog, go online or call toll-free.
Working beats waiting.
All right, folks, this week we've decided to do something a little bit different than we've been doing here lately, which is a lot of heavy lifting on the Camaro behind me, with the exception of the interlude with the Woodward Dream Cruise. We're going to be doing a piece on how to set up your car for restoration and what order you should restore things in, but I'm going to do that just a little bit differently. I'm going to actually go in and do it with three different types of cars, the first being a street driver, the next being a cruise night car, and the final one being a full-on show car, and give you a list of the order in which I do things when we're working on them around here. Now, this all comes about because we got a letter in from one of our readers that wanted to know how we did this. And the letter reads, Jeff, I'm working on a 67 Mustang Fastback, and I'm about to start the restoration on this car. How should I go about it? What should I do first? Can you help me with this, please? And I'm not going to give you his name because I didn't get his permission. In any case, okay, one of the first things I'm going to say is in all restorations, safety first. Whenever you're building this car, make sure that you do everything you can to make it as safe as you possibly can so that when you drive it or someone else drives your car, they get in it and they don't have any kind of issues. It doesn't take you 15 minutes and a full list to show them how to get the car to start and run, what the brakes are going to do, how they should react to these situations. You want to make sure that the car that you provide to someone is basically like a brand new car coming off of a showroom floor in essence. And what I mean by that is this. You shouldn't have to tell a guy, hey, if you don't be careful, the brakes are going to pull to the left. If you're on an undulated road, blah, 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 blah. You shouldn't have to do any of that. You should be able to hand the keys over to somebody to let them drive your car. The next thing I'm going to tell you is you need to go in and figure out what your 95% is going to be on this car. Don't build a show car if all you really need is a street driver car that you're just going to take the wife and kids out or the husband and kids out on a cruise in the afternoon just to have a little bit of fun and go somewhere. If you're not a cruise night person and you're not a show car person, a street driver car is going to A, be a lot cheaper for you to build, and B, it's going to be something that you can just go out and wing and have fun in and not have to worry about paint chips and all that other kind of stuff. Or buying a $20,000 trailer to haul your car around in because you've done so many things to it, you're paranoid to let it get out in the sun or the rain. So that's that. Now I'm going to start talking to you a little bit about what you need to do whenever you're building a street driver car. Now, what is a street driver car? Well, a street driver car is one that you're not really going to be building for any kind of show use at all. This is just for your own personal enjoyment, as I said before. The method that I use is my own method. This is how I would go about doing this. If you have a better method that you'd like to send in to us or put in the comments below, we would be more than happy to hear from you about how you set up and do your car. Number one thing to do, keep it moving. If the car starts to sit inside the garage and get boxes stacked up on it, like the 67 Camaro I'm showing you right now, you got a problem. It's not then a street driver car, and it will probably never move again, at least until you decide to sell it or some wild hair gets up your hiney and you decide to go in and finish the car up. Always work on safety. Safety is your main concern on this, and that would be going in and getting your suspension fixed up and in good condition. You don't have to put disc brakes on these cars, but I would highly recommend it as part of your suspension rebuild. And when you're doing these things, make sure that your projects are done over the course of one weekend. If you can do it that way and get it back on the street Monday, the street driver is going to then indeed be a street driver. The next thing you want to do, number two, is your driveline. Make sure that everything within the driveline is in good working order. The transmission shifts fine. The engine doesn't have any knocks in it and all of that. Make sure the rear axle is in good shape, good universal joints, so that you feel comfortable driving this car pretty much anywhere you want to go. Do you need a fully rebuilt engine? No. A lot of times you can get away on these cases without doing that. If you're going to put an engine in it, again, owing to our weekend warrior approach, go ahead and buy yourself a crate motor and put it in there and put the other engine from the car on an engine stand. That way you're assured of having a fresh engine. You'll usually get a warranty with it, so that if something does go wrong, you can take it back to the manufacturer and argue with them for hours and hours about why it's not your fault and it's their fault, and they can tell you that it's your fault, not their fault. Don't ask me how I know that. Okay, the next thing, number three after that, would be I would go in and start working on my interior and getting the interior in better nick. If you've got ripped seats, go ahead and buy yourself a set of seat covers. But if you're doing seat covers, my opinion is go ahead and do the buns with it, unless the buns in the car are in really good shape. If your buns are in good shape, you can leave them in there. Anyway, so when you're doing this, recover your seats, maybe put a new carpet set in it, new door panels, because all of these items, though expensive on the whole, can be done over the course of several weekends and over the course of several months. You don't have to do all this stuff in one big shot. You can recover your seats, then pull the seats out at some point down the road, put the new carpet set in, then down the road again, put new door panels on. A lot of the products for cars like Mustangs and Camaros are actually fairly inexpensive unless you get up into the deluxe interior stuff. So you can do this a little bit at a time and save yourself some money. Also, when you're in the interior, just paint things. Clean it up. Make it look nice. It doesn't have to be perfect because it's just a driver like the car behind me, but if it's clean, people will look at it and be able to appreciate it. Number four is paint and body. Now, there is one thing within paint and body that I would move to the top of my list, and that would be to go in and do things like floor pans, anything that's structural on the car that needs repairing, no matter what kind of car it is. If you have pieces that are rusted through or have problems like that that are structural related that can be considered paint and body, I would go ahead and do those first. Get your floor pans done on anything that's unit body product. Now, you can save yourself a little bit of money if you want to paint your car yourself by going out and doing what they call a Rust-Oleum roller paint job. I'm not going to go into what that is. You can go out on the internet. There are literally hundreds of places that have done it and shown how to do it. It looks magnificent, but I will tell you right now, this is not a one weekend job. This is going to consume a couple of weekends, but you can get really good results. The only problem I've had with it is the lack of colors available that are original colors on most of these 60s muscle cars. They're not out there. Unless you're doing black on a black car, you're in kind of trouble, because what happens is I'm not real sure how you can get a very small foam roller inside the door jamb of a car like this 67 Camaro back behind me. And that's going to create an issue with the paint job. So, how to deal with that, I don't know. Rust-Oleum paint job, $50, not a bad idea, especially on a street driver car. The final thing, the fifth thing, would be to go in and start working on the chrome, say your bumpers, any of the aluminum stuff that's on the outside of the car and your stainless, get all that freshened up, and the car should be really nice for you to drive around in. People will give you thumbs up, stop you at the gas stations and tell you what a cool car you have, and you'll be late everywhere you go, but I guarantee you when you do that, you're going to be a lot happier driving it than you would, say, a brand new Camry. Well, except for maybe the lack of air conditioning and stuff like that, but you know. All right, next up on our list is the Cruise Night Local Car Show car. Now, this one is basically like our street driver, but there are a few things that I do a little differently on these, and most of them have to do with the detail level I put into the car. But I'm going to go through the order that we do them and give you an idea of what that means. Again, like our street driver car, you keep this car moving. You don't take it off the road for any length of time if you can help it. Now, it's not a car that you're driving on a super regular basis, but it is a car that you're actually spending some time in on the weekends. So you can afford to have it down for a few more days if you need to do things. For instance, our 69 Fairlane Wagon is not a beautiful car, but this car is one that we're going to be setting up for going to car shows and cruise-ins and local things like that. So the car has that sort of purpose behind it, meaning I'm not going to spend a ton of time detailing the undercarriage, not going to spend any time in the wheel wells, but I am going to go in and detail the engine bay on it. So all the things that applied from our street driver, from going in and making safety your priority, doing your suspension and driveline, getting those things sussed out and worked out, moving into the interior, and then finally paint and body, and then chrome, all of those list outs that we did before are going to apply in this situation as well. The differences we're going to run into are things like whenever I go in and do my brakes. I am going to use stainless lines on the wagon because I want it to look nice and stay looking nice. Now, the one thing I do recommend you do is that you keep your projects weekend warrior projects. Try to do everything to where you can work on the weekends or maybe a little bit in the evenings along. Because, like I said, your goal is to keep this car in running condition to take to a cruise night so that once a month or two or three times a month, you can do these kind of things. So, when you're looking at engines, I still would look at the idea of a crate motor, although it is easy enough at that point to pull the engine and transmission out of the car and do that stuff to it. The big difference is, as I said before, you're going to be detailing that engine bay to make it look really nice when you pop that hood at the cruise night. Interior detail needs to be a lot bigger too. You need to spend a lot more time on it, maybe recover both the front and the back seats on the car, going in and putting new carpet sets, redoing all the chrome stuff inside the interior, say the plastic pieces need to be replated, buy the stuff from guys like National Parts Depot, or if you're going to go in and do a car that doesn't have the plastic parts inside the interior available in the aftermarket, you may need to go to somebody like G-Car Plastic Plating up in Washington State to get that kind of thing done. The engine, in my opinion, if you're gonna wow people at car shows and cruise nights, needs to have a really good hot radical cam in it. Even if it's not that big a deal of an engine, if it sounds really tough, people are gonna notice it when you come into the cruise night or the local car show. Chrome, oddly enough, on some of these cars is going to be one of your bigger expenses to have to put out when you're doing a nice cruise night slash local car show build. So from there, we're going to move on to the big guns. We're going to be talking about show cars and what we do with that, which is completely different from what we do with a cruise night or a street driver car. All right, folks, the show car. Now, this is a car that's going to try to compete nationally or at least regionally in whatever kind of event you're choosing for the car. The first thing I'll say about a show car is the car really needs to be a good, solid base. Oddly enough, the 67 Camaro back here behind me stands a chance of being a really good national show car because, oddly enough, the car is quite solid. There's a little bit of rust in some places, but nothing cataclysmic. We're not talking about having to go in and rebuild the entire undercarriage of the car. So, in the start-off point, when you're going to do a show car, you want it to be a top-flight car, something that is really exceptional. Beyond all that, if you're going to be building a show car out of what you've got, things become a lot different when you're doing this. One of the things you're going to need is a cataclysmic amount of space. Trying to do this in a standard small 20 by 22 garage that a lot of houses have on them is going to be very, very tough because some of the things you're going to need are going to consume a ton more space than the 20 by 22 is going to allow for. Like, for instance, if you decide to do this and do what they call a full rotisserie restoration. Unlike rotisserie chicken, this is something that you will be doing to your car, and it does consume a vast amount of space. Depending on the type of rotating assembly you have and what kind of car you're working on, you can have this thing be well larger than the garage you're going to be working in. So keep that in your mind whenever you're doing this. Okay, one of the other things I'm going to tell you you're going to need to do is to completely gut the car. And when you do that, this is the other reason you're going to need space because everything in that car will be coming out. And when everything comes out, you have to have a place to put it. Even with our 69 Fairlane, while we're building up parts, we're taking up shelf space in our garage for the parts that we're building up to put back into this cruise night car. Imagine if the Fairlane were a full-on Concours rebuild. Even more space would be consumed because we want to take everything off the car and put everything back on it. You're also going to want to go in and be able to take the car and have things done to it, like, say, getting it media blasted or whatever in preparation for paint. I will say this, when you're disassembling, everything should come off the car, but the suspension should possibly be taken off and reapplied enough so that the car is mobile. A nasty set of tires is almost a requirement when you're doing one of these type of cars. That way the car is mobile enough for you to take it to all the different locations that are going to need to be doing things to it, because you probably are not going to be painting your own car. You're probably going to be taking this to somebody else to have it done. So your number one thing to do is to remove the drive line. Number two would be to go in and take the interior out. Number three would be to go out and blow everything off the outside of the car. And the last thing you would need to do is to go in and start removing the suspension and setting it up on something. I would recommend building some kind of cart to set it on, or as I said, put it on a rotisserie if you're going to be doing the work yourself. If you're going to be putting floor pans in the car and you're going to be doing rust repair, the rotisserie is probably the best way to get that done, because it'll make it easier to get in and do it. If the floor pans are good, the rotisserie is still a great idea for being able to go in and clean the undercarriage of a car that has seen road grime from whatever year it was built to today or when it was last driven on the street. And if you get really lucky, somebody may have gone in and done a Z-Bart treatment on the car back in the day, and you'll be sitting there spending hours of fun trying to get the tar and junk that they used back then at Z-Bart off the bottom side of the car. It will have saved it, but you're going to get really tired of working on taking all that junk off of it. Now, weird thing is, bodywork and paint come first. In my opinion, after I've blown the car apart, the first thing I want to do is to send it off to what my friend likes to call paint jail. And the reason we call it paint jail is, no matter what people tell you at the restoration shop, when you take it in to get it painted, they'll say you'll have it done in 3 weeks. I don't think that painter 3 weeks and normal people 3 weeks is the same thing. And I don't mean painters are weird. I mean that things happen. To my mind, there's not a whole lot you can do about this. A lot of times when it goes into a paint shop, your car is not the only one in there, and you're put into a queue, and they work on it when they can. You may have the paint shop tell you it's only going to take 3 weeks, and it ends up being 3 months. I've seen this happen time and time again at top flight restoration shops. You just run into stuff. Say they pull the car apart, and there's something that they need to put on it that they can't get right away, or they have to hunt for. Your car gets pulled out of queue, and then suddenly it has to bump into other things until finally they find a slot for it. So keep in mind that when you're doing this, you're going to probably end up with a car that's going to take a little bit longer to get the restoration done on it when you send it off for paint. But paint should be number one. Number two, when you get the car back from paint, you want to start putting your suspension on the car to get it back on the ground so it's rollable inside your shop. That way, if you need to do something like paint things or work on something that's a little more gritty, like say restoration of components, you can pull the car outside, leave it sitting outside while you're working inside the garage so you don't damage the work that's been done by the paint shop. The next thing after that will be my drive line. I want to get my drive line in it. Get some of the dash components in there, start the engine, make sure everything within all that works correctly and looks good and is in the right place. The next thing you want to do is the interior on the car, putting your headliners in, getting the carpet in, the seats in, checking door fitment, make sure that the panels are correct. All this kind of stuff starts tying in together to getting the completion on the car. Now, body panel alignment, you can either have the shop do that or you can try to do it yourself. My personal opinion is to have an initial light alignment of the body panels done, then put all your junk on the car, and then take the car back to the shop to have them final align the components so that every seam is in good shape. All right, and the final thing you want to do is put the chrome on the car, and that's really your last thing, and the car is ready to go do the show circuit. Now, this is an oversimplified version, I know, but what we're talking about here is giving you the basics of the way I would do this if I were building the car myself. Well, that's our show for this week, folks. I hope you enjoyed what we did here. It's a little different than what we normally do, but we did have a reader write in, actually more than one, asking us what they should do with their car. In fact, the owner of the Camaro behind me has asked that same question. What should my process be on the car? Which kind of sparked me into going ahead and doing this episode. So, that's the one for this week. Do us a favor and come back and watch us next time on Autorestomod. Have a great week, folks. Mic check.
This is not our funny, guys. This is a band take.